Laudetur Jesus Christus. Praised be Jesus Christ. And welcome this evening to the celebration of Evening Prayer 1, or also known as First Vespers and the singing of the Te Deum. We're coming to you here from St. Peter's Basilica on New Year's Eve, the vigil of the Solemnity of Mary, the Mother of God. The procession now entering. With the Archpriest of the Vatican Basilica, Cardinal Mauro Gambetti, at the end of the procession. We see the throne set up here as well with the Word of God. Our Holy Father will be presiding. And I'd like to take this opportunity to welcome you all, many of you joining us through our own Vatican media channels, our Vatican News Live Events app, the Vatican Radio app, the Vatican News English web portal, YouTube channel, or Facebook Live feed. Welcome to all of you joining us through the television stations picking up this broadcast, Catholic TV, Catholic Faith Network, Shalom World Television Networks, EWTN, Salt and Light Media, Shalom TV India, and Sunday Shalom at Madarshan TV and Uganda Catholic Television. All of you joining us through radio stations, some of you joining through Radio Maria England, others through Luminous Radio, and all of you tuning in through other local or diocesan radio stations, and all of you joining through other digital platforms.
O Dio, vieni a salvarmi.
And we begin.
Gloria al Padre, al Figlio e allo Spirito Santo.
Come era nel principio, e ora e sempre, nei secoli dei secoli. Amen. Alleluia.
And the Vespers open with the chant of the Ave Maristella, Hail Star of the Sea, a plain song Vespers hymn from about the 8th century. And as we move into the psalmody, I'd like to also welcome our friends making the American Sign Language broadcast possible at DYCIA. O marvelous exchange, man's creator has become man, born of a virgin. We have been made sharers in the divinity of Christ, who humbled himself to share in our humanity. O servants of the Lord, praise the name of the Lord. May the name of the Lord be blessed both now and forever. From the rising of the sun to its setting, praised be the name of the Lord. High above all nations is the Lord, above the heavens his glory. Who is like the Lord our God, who has risen on high to his throne, yet stoops from the heights to look down upon heaven and earth. From the dust he lifts up the lowly, from his misery he raises the poor, to set him in the company of princes, yes, with the princes of his people. To the childless wife he gives a home and gladdens her heart with children. To the second psalm.
Oh,
miraculous birth of the Virgin, you have fulfilled the scriptures, like a gentle rain falling upon the earth. You have come down to save your people. O God, we praise you.
Glorifica il Signore Gerusalemme, loda Sion il tuo Dio, perché ha rinforzato le sbarre delle tue porte, in mezzo a te ha benedetto i tuoi figli. Egli ha messo pace nei tuoi confini e ti sazia con fior di frumento.
Oh, praise the Lord, Jerusalem. Zion, praise your God. He has strengthened the bars of your gates. He has blessed the children within you. He established peace on your borders. He feeds you with finest wheat. He sends out his word to the earth and swiftly runs his command. He showers down snow white as wool. He scatters hoarfrost like ashes. He hurls down hailstones like crumbs. The waters are frozen at his touch. He sends forth his word, and it melts them. At the breath of his mouth, the waters flow. He makes his word known to Jacob, to Israel, his laws and decrees. He has not dealt thus with other nations. He has not taught them his decrees. Now we move into the canticle from the letter of Paul to the Ephesians. Your blessed and fruitful virginity is like the bush, flaming yet unburned, which Moses saw on Sinai.
Thank you.
Praised be the Father, praised be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has bestowed on us in Christ every spiritual blessing in the heavens. God chose us in him before the world began to be holy and blameless in his sight. He predestined us to be his adopted sons through Jesus Christ. Such was his will and pleasure, that all might praise the glorious favor he has bestowed on us in his beloved. In him and through his blood we have been redeemed, and our sins forgiven. So immeasurably generous is God's favor to us. God has given us the wisdom to understand fully the mystery, the plan he was pleased to decree in Christ, a plan to be carried out in Christ in the fullness of time, to bring all things into one in him, in the heavens and on earth.
Quando venne la pienezza del tempo, Dio mandò il suo figlio, nato da donna, nato sotto la legge, per riscattare coloro che erano sotto la legge.
When the designated time had come, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to deliver from the law those who were subjected to it, so that we might receive our status as adopted sons. After this brief reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Galatians, we pause for a moment, and soon we'll hear a brief homily prepared by Pope Francis.
La fede ci permette di vivere quest'ora.
Faith enables us to live this hour differently. Differently from a worldly mentality. Faith in Jesus Christ, God incarnate, born of the Virgin Mary, gives a new way of experiencing time and life. I would sum it up in two words: gratitude and hope. Someone might say, but isn't that what everyone does on this last night of the year? Everyone give thanks, everyone is hopeful, whether you're a believer or a non-believer. Perhaps it might seem that way, and perhaps it is, but in reality, worldly gratitude, worldly hope are apparent. They lack the essential dimension, which is the relationship with the other and with others, with God and with our brothers and sisters. They're focused on the self, on our interests, And so they're short breaths. They don't go beyond satisfaction or optimism. Instead, in this liturgy, there's a whole other atmosphere, that of praise, of awe, of gratitude. And this is happening not because of the majesty of the Basilica, not because of the lights or the songs. These things are rather the consequence, but because of the mystery that the antiphon of the first psalm expressed like this, wonderful exchange. The Creator took on a soul and a body and was born of a virgin, and He gives us His divinity. This wonderful or marvelous exchange. The liturgy allows us to feel what the Church feels, and the Church, as it were, learns this from the Virgin Mother. Let us think what that gratitude may have been in Mary's heart as she looked at the newborn Jesus. It's an experience that only a mother can have, and yet in her, in the Mother of God, it was a unique and incomparable depth. Mary knows. She alone knows, along with Joseph, where that child comes from, and yet he's there, he's breathing, he's crying, he needs to eat, he needs to be covered and cared for. And this mystery gives space to gratitude, which surfaces in the contemplation of the gift, in it's a gratuitous gift. And the Church learns this gratitude from the Virgin Mary, and she also learns hope. It comes to mind that God chose her, Mary of Nazareth, because He saw His own hope reflected in her heart, that which He Himself had infused into her with His Spirit. Mary had always been filled with love, filled with grace, and because of this, she is filled with trust and hope. That of Mary and the Church is not optimism. It's something else. It's faith in God, who is faithful to His promises. And this faith takes the form of hope in the dimension of time, we might say, on the way. The Christian, like Mary, is a pilgrim of hope, and this will be the theme of the Jubilee of 2025, Pilgrims of Hope. Dear brothers and sisters, we can ask ourselves, is Rome preparing to become, in the Holy Year, a city of hope? We all know that the organization of this Jubilee has been underway for some time, but do we understand that in the perspective we take here, it's not primarily about that, but it's rather about the witness of the ecclesial and civil community, a witness that, more than in events, consists in a style of life, in an ethical and spiritual quality of living together. And so the question can be formulated like this. Are we working each in his or her own sphere so that this city might be a sign of hope for those who live in it and for those who will visit it? An example, entering St. Peter's Square and seeing that in the embrace of the colonnade, people of every nationality, culture, and religions move about freely and serenely is an experience that instills hope. But it is important that it be confirmed by a warm welcome in the visit to the Basilica, as well as in the information services. Another example, the charm of the historic center of Rome is perennial and universal, but it needs to be enjoyed also by those who are elderly or those who have difficulty moving about. And it's necessary that the great beauty be matched by simple decorum and normal functionality in the places and situations of ordinary weekday life. For a city that is more livable for its own citizens is also more welcoming to everyone else. Dear brothers and sisters, a pilgrimage, especially a demanding one, requires a good preparation. That is why this coming year, which precedes the Jubilee, is dedicated to prayer. It's an entire year dedicated to prayer. And what better teacher could we have than our Holy Mother? Let's put ourselves in her school. Let's learn from her to live each day, each moment, each occupation with our inner gaze turned to Jesus. Joys and sorrows, satisfactions and problems, everything in the presence of and with the grace of Jesus, the Lord. Everything with gratitude and hope. And accompanying this meditation, we see an icon here of the suckling Madonna, who is nursing, the nursing Madonna, created by a person thought to be Gualtiero, an artist, who after a fall from scaffolding, he broke his arm and was said to have been healed by Saint William. And then he became a monk and painted this image. This particular icon dates back to the 12th and 13th centuries, the work of an artist from Campania. It's tempera on chestnut wood boards, three different boards. And when we see that image again, you'll see the particular dress Our Lady is wearing, typical dress from the Eastern Roman Empire. Now we move on to our responsory.
Alleluia, alleluia.
The Word was made man. Alleluia, alleluia. He lived among us. Alleluia, alleluia. Church raises the gospel canticle, the Magnificat. From the outset, Christian communities have made this Mary's hymn of joy their own. It's found in the first chapter of Luke. Antiphon, in his great love for us, God sent his Son in the likeness of our sinful nature, born of a woman and subject to the law. Alleluia. Ministers, our Holy Father has put incense in the thurifers.
Magnificat.
My soul proclaims the greatness of the Lord. My spirit rejoices in God, my Savior, for he has looked with favor on his lowly servant. From this day, all generations will call me blessed. The Almighty has done great things for me, and holy is his name. He has mercy on those who fear him in every generation. He has shown the strength of his arm. He has scattered the proud in their conceit. He has cast down the mighty from their thrones and has lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he has sent away empty. He has come to the help of his servant Israel, for he has remembered his promise of mercy, the promise he made to our fathers, to Abraham and his children forever. Now begins the intercessory prayer.
Invochiamo il Cristo, nostra pace, che è venuto.
Let us invoke Christ, our peace, who came to unite in one soul people, men and women of every tongue and nation. And the response is, Lord, grant your peace to all.
Dona a tutti la tua pace, Signore.
Dona a tutti la tua pace, Signore.
Tu che venendo fra noi hai rivelato l'amore.
When you were born, you revealed the Father's love. Help us always to be grateful for all your blessings.
Tu che hai voluto, piena di grazia, Maria, tua madre, fondi su tutti gli uomini la bondà.
You made Mary, your mother, full of grace. Give all people the fullness of grace.
Portato al mondo il lieto annunzio della salvezza, moltiplica gli araldi e di.
You came to announce God's good news to the world. Increase the number of preachers and hearers of your word.
Voluto nascere da Maria Vergine come nostro fratello, insegna tutti gli uomini.
You desired to become our brother by being born of the Virgin Mary. Teach all men and women to love each other in mutual brotherhood.
Sole di giustizia apparso all'orizzonte dell'umanità, risplendi ai nostri.
You came as the Sun of Justice rising over the earth. Show the light of your countenance on those who have died. Now we're invited to pray the Lord's Prayer.
O
God, who through the fruitful virginity of Blessed Mary bestowed on the human race the grace of eternal salvation, grant, we pray, that we may experience the intercession of her through whom we were found worthy to receive the author of life.
Amen.
And at this point, the Te Deum intoned, a Christian hymn of thanksgiving par excellence, traditionally sung on New Year's Eve, to thank the Lord for the past year.
Thank you.
We've just heard the chanting of the Te Deum.
Signore sia con voi.
And now the blessing.
Sia benedetto il nome del Signore. Nostro aiuto nel nome del Signore.
Egli ha fatto cielo e terra.
Vi benedica Dio onnipotente, Padre, Figli e Spirito Santo.
Amen.
Ite in pace.
And at the conclusion of these first Vespers, the chant of the Marian Antiphon, the Alma Redemptoris Mater. Loving Mother of our Redeemer, Gate of Heaven, Star of the Sea, hasten to aid thy fallen people who strive to rise once more. Thou who brought forth thy holy Creator, all creation wondering, yet remainest ever virgin. Taking from Gabriel's lips that joyful hail, be merciful to us sinners. Procession now forming and moving down the aisle here in St. Peter's Basilica. We've seen participating here the mayor of Rome, Roberto Gualtieri. We also heard references, our Holy Father referring to the city of Rome, which in the year 2025 will be welcoming pilgrims from throughout the world as we celebrate the holy year, the Jubilee year. Father has now gotten into the wheelchair we've become accustomed to seeing him in, but it hasn't kept him from going out to the world. In this past year, he undertook 5 apostolic journeys, visiting the Democratic Republic of the Congo, South Sudan, Hungary, Lisbon, Portugal for World Youth Day, Mongolia. And he went to the Mediterranean meeting in Marseille. And the Master of Ceremonies now handing him the baby Jesus, whom he kisses. So in these 5 apostolic journeys, our Holy Father traveled 36,700 kilometers this year, although being confined to a wheelchair. He's now greeting the mayor of Rome, Roberto Gualtieri, here. It's customary for the mayor to be present at the end of the year Vespers. He's now greeting other people in wheelchairs here. And we now bring this live broadcast of the celebration of evening prayer, our first Vespers, and the singing of the Te Deum, presided over by Pope Francis on New Year's Eve, the vigil of the Solemnity of Mary, the Mother of God. I invite you to visit the Vatican News web portal, Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter accounts for a summary of this evening's Vespers, as well as coverage of other Vatican and world news. And we'll be back again tomorrow, 10 a.m. Rome time. Pope Francis will preside over Holy Mass for the Solemnity of Mary, the Mother of God. On behalf of Vatican Media, I'd like to thank all of our media partners, Catholic TV, Catholic Faith Network, Shalom World Television Networks, EWTN, Salt and Light Media, Shalom TV India, and Sunday Shalom at Madarshan TV, and Uganda Catholic Television, Radio Maria England, and Luminous Radio, and our friends at DYCIA who've made this broadcast possible, as well as our in-studio audio technician Adriano Vitali and coordinator Massimiliano Menichetti, who've made this broadcast possible. I'm Sister Bernadette Reese. It's been a pleasure providing you with this end of the year Vespers. I wish you all a most blessed new year with many, many blessings. Laudetur Jesus Christus. Praised be Jesus Christ. Father, Holy Father is now going to be visiting the crib, the nativity scene set up in St. Peter's Square. It's been a little while since we saw him visit that after this celebration. The Nativity set, a tribute to Saint Francis of Assisi, who was the first to ever put up a Nativity scene. And he did so in the hamlet of Greccio here in Italy 800 years ago, 1223 to be exact. And he did so after visiting Bethlehem. And on his way back, he was inspired to actually set up a nativity scene, which he did in Greccio because it reminded him of Bethlehem. It resembled Bethlehem to him. Our Holy Father still in the Basilica greeting people who have come here. And it was released just the other day that in this past year, unfortunately, the tally of Catholic missionaries who have been killed numbers 20 missionaries who've lost their lives around the world to a violent death. However, what a beautiful witness for us as Christians that there are still people who are willing to give their lives, believing in the promises made by the Lord. Like Mary, we believe that they will be fulfilled. The Information Service of the Pontifical Mission Society, Vatican Fides News Agency, reported yesterday that that number 20 includes one bishop, eight priests, two men religious, one seminarian, one novice, and seven lay people. The most deadly continent being that of Africa, where nine people were killed, and Latin America, where six were killed. In the Philippines, in Asia, there were four Catholic lay people murdered in 2023. Here, the cameras have now brought us to this nativity scene that was set up this year. The setting up of the nativity, or actually the Christmas tree in St. Peter's, going back to Pope John Paul II, a gift that he left for the celebration of Christmas. So now we see the person actually holding the baby Jesus, not Saint Joseph, but Saint Francis, and there are other figures of Saint Francis in this scene, representing various aspects of his life. The structure is 17 meters wide and 10 meters deep and 8 meters high. 103 people worked on constructing this nativity scene, and numerous companies in Italy worked on it together. The nativity scene in Italy, taking on various art forms, it's been highly developed, and generally not only depicts the birth of our Lord in the stable in Bethlehem, but places the scene of that birth in the setting of everyday normal life. And it keeps getting updated as years go by. Here we see one of the scenes actually in the shrine in Greccio, commemorating the time when the first nativity was set up. And we're seeing the tree now, 28 meter or 91 feet high, coming from Macra, a town in the Piedmont region of Italy. This tree was already set to be cut down. It was at risk of toppling over. And once it's removed from the square on January 8th, that's next Monday, the day after the feast of the baptism of the Lord, the wood will be used to make toys for children. So it will definitely be put to good use. As we know, it's been a year since Pope Benedict XVI died. He died exactly a year ago today, and our Holy Father remembered him this morning in his remarks after the Angelus, saying, a year ago, Pope Benedict XVI ended his earthly journey after having lovingly and wisely served the Church. We feel so much affection, gratitude, and admiration for him. And he said he blesses us and accompanies us from heaven. And then he invited everyone there to give a round of applause to the late Pope Benedict XVI. This morning, our Holy Father also recalled that in Nigeria, the celebration of Christmas was unfortunately marked by serious violence in the state of Plateau. Many victims, some counts put it at 100, but others think it may be as high as 200. Our Holy Father said he's praying for the victims and their families, and then prayed, may God free Nigeria from these atrocities. And as we look on this image, we now see images of Pope Francis now outside in his wheelchair being wheeled toward the nativity scene here set up in St. Peter's Square. We recall his words also from this morning, asking us to continue to pray for the people who are suffering because of war. He recalled the beleaguered people of Ukraine, the people of Palestine and Israel, the people of Sudan and many other countries. And he then said at the end of the year, let us have the courage to ask ourselves, how many human lives have been broken by armed conflict? How many people have died? How much destruction, suffering, and poverty? And he said, may those who have interests in these conflicts listen to the voice of their conscience. And he said, let us not forget the suffering Rohingya people. Our Holy Father out among the people now, waiting in St. Peter's Square. And also in celebrating or commemorating the first anniversary of the death of Pope Benedict, Archbishop Gangschwein, his former secretary, recalled how just a year ago, Pope Benedict himself called Christmas the most beautiful day of the year. And he reflected on that day that he also celebrated Christmas with Pope Benedict, the last Christmas he would celebrate on earth. And he said today, the Feast of the Holy Family marks the first anniversary of Pope Benedict's return to the Father's house, where, as we hope and pray, he may forever contemplate the great mystery of Christmas. He also said that Pope Benedict XVI's prayer life was distinguished by increasing intensity after he resigned. One of contemplation of the one Lord who in the power of the Spirit continues to guide his church, Archbishop Gangschwein said. He also said that Benedict strived to follow the example of Saint Joseph, our Holy Father now greeting the director of the Vatican Governorate and the Vice Director here. And they are the ones who organize the gift here of the crib and the tree every year here in St. Peter's Square. Sister Raffaella and Cardinal Alzaga. Cardinal Fernando Vergés Alzaga. And our Holy Father here now in contemplating the scene here. recommend our Holy Father making the sign of the cross here. As we see the music being played by the Pontifical Swiss Guard. And once again, we see Sister Raffaella Petrini and Cardinal Fernando Verges Alzaga from the Vatican Governorate. And now other people working in the governorate now coming up and greeting our Holy Father here in the square. Today being the Feast of the Holy Family, our Holy Father in a special way said he was thinking of families today. He sent out a particular blessing to families, all of those present in the square, and all those who were connected by means of communication. He said, let us not forget that the family is the basic cell of society. It always needs to be defended and sustained, always. And he reminded us that the Holy Family of Jesus, Mary, and Joseph themselves had to face obstacles during their life, picking up on the line of Simeon to Mary in today's gospel, that a sword would pierce her heart. And so he said that the Holy Family picked up an added burden of suffering with that prophecy. And he said, isn't that surprising? How is it that the family of Jesus, the only family in history who could boast of having God present in flesh and blood among them, that instead of being rich, they were poor. Instead of having things easy, they met with obstacles. And instead of being free from hardship, that family was immersed in tremendous sorrow. And he said, well, what does that tell our families? And he said, well, it says something very beautiful. He said, it means that God, whom we often imagine to be beyond problems, is actually living them with us. He came to live our life with its problems. He didn't come to avoid problems, but he assumed problems like we do. And so he says, in choosing to live in a family, Jesus says to us, if you're facing difficulties, I know what you're experiencing because I experienced it too. He said, we experience difficulty so we can say to your family, you are not alone. What a beautiful message, especially for those who may be suffering due to the many problems in today's world, war or famine. Families on the move, trying to seek a better life. Yesterday, the last audience of the year, our Holy Father met with singers who belong to the Puerti Cantores Federation. He met with about 1,000 members from 24 25 countries. And these are all children and young people who sing in choirs. In fact, the music that we heard tonight during the Vespers, of course, the Sistine Chapel Choir conducted by Maestro Marcos Pavan and organist Maestro Joseph Sole Cole. But there was also a guest choir among them from St. Patrick's Cathedral in New York, and we saw them in their choir robes as well. We can feel the joy of the people here. Our Holy Father now reaching out to a baby, being held in the arms of a mother, caressing the child, extending his hand, waving. And at this point now, we bring this commentary. We've been watching our Holy Father visiting the crib scene in St. Peter's Square. And once again, I'd like to invite you back tomorrow morning at 10 o'clock Rome time. Our Holy Father will be presiding over Mass on the solemnity of Mary, the Mother of God. Once again, I'd like to thank our media partners, Catholic TV, Catholic Faith Network, Shalom World Television Networks, EWTN, Salt and Light Media, Shalom TV India, and Sunday Shalom, at Madarshan TV and Uganda Catholic Television, Radio Maria England, and Luminous Radio, and especially to our friends at DYCIA who've made the American Sign Language translation possible. And once again, I wish you all a most blessed new year. Laudetur Jesus Christus, praised be Jesus Christ.